Hello and welcome to the Waters Bioanalysis Method Development Builder for the Oasis Ion Exchange Sorbents. In the next few minutes, we'll go through a very quick overview of how to use this particular tool in developing very powerful solid phase extraction applications for your bioanalytical samples. The amazing thing about this tool is once you become familiar with it, it only takes a couple of minutes to input all the information regarding your application, and then the tool will provide you with the choice of SPE configuration and sorbent, as well as the individual steps to the method, and also at the same time provide you with the techniques to do an evaluation of how well the particular method will work for your applications, and looking at things like recovery and mass spec interferences. The structure of the presentation, there will be a separate keystroke demo. This particular module is focused on tabs 1, 2, and 3 of the actual software tool, and that's actually creating your method and testing it. And then there is an advanced section, which is also available separately, which will allow you to look at tabs 4 and 5, which will go through better understanding of ion exchange principles, especially for those who are new to solid phase extraction in your laboratory, some of your new colleagues. And also, if the tool doesn't quite meet the goals for your method, there is an optimization module available separately. So there are a total 5 tabs in the procedure. You can see the tabs listed up on top, creating the method, prepare the standards, method protocols, understanding the principles of ion exchange, and optimizing the method. So what we're going to do is focus on tabs 1, 2, and 3, which are the specific sections that allow you to input your information and basically receive a complete method laid out for you. This is your input form. This is actually the opening tab, tab 1, for the creating the bioanalysis method. You'll see there are 7 inputs that you'll need to fill in. First 4 are designed to help select the sorbent and the product configuration, the amount of mass of sorbent. The next 3 are designed to help actually create the steps of the method. We're going to use this as an example protocol for the sample. We're going to use some weak bases. We have 96-well plate format, load volume 500 to 1,000 microliters. For this particular method, we're going to specify 500 microliters for load. And the concentration of our analytes will be 200 nanograms per milliliter. And we're going to use 6 data points for basically calculating the reproducibility of the system when we look at recovery and matrix effects. So 6 replicates will be required. Now, there's some conventions that I like to use for helping people understand and keeping straight the concepts of ion exchange, and there is more information available to you. But basically, I'm going to use the convention that strong means the compound or the sorbent material is always charged. Weak means the compound or the sorbent material is sometimes charged, and as you change pH, it can go from charged to uncharged. Generally, what we're going to do is match a strong to a weak. That means in order to create an initial strong capture, we're going to utilize ion exchange. So for a weak analyte, we'll use a strong ion exchange sorbent, and vice versa. And this will allow us to eventually shut off the ion exchange by shutting off one of the charges so that we can release our compounds from the device. The Oasis family of materials is built on the Oasis HLB, which is purely reverse phase. And then we take and functionalize the particle, the HLB particle, with strong or weak ion exchangers, both for the cation exchangers as well as the anion exchangers. And they all have specific properties. And what the tool will do is basically choose which one of these ion exchangers best meets the needs for your particular sample. Typically, your sample will be some kind of an aqueous base sample with polar, nonpolar, maybe even charged species in there. And the ion exchange and reverse phase mechanism we find to be the most powerful. That's why the Oasis ion exchange reverse phase solvents are used. And there are four of them: the strong cation exchange, MCX, weak cation exchange, WCX, strong anion exchange, MAX, and weak anion exchange, WAX. So the tool will automatically select which of those solvents best meets your needs. Just to simplify again, for the world of analytes, we're going to use the weak and strong concept. So you can see a weak base at low pH is charged, but at high pH it's not charged. A strong base is charged at both low and high pH. So you can see we've laid out here what happens to analytes as you change the pH of the mobile phase. And this is a very important thing to understand in chromatography in general, both for reverse phase as well as for ion exchange. Because if you create the opposite attracting properties of two species with charge, then you create a very strong retention mechanism. When you actually select, and here we have from the drop-down menu, we're going to select for our example the basic compounds with weak bases because they have pKa of 2 to 10. Notice immediately the tool will come back with the strong cation exchanger. If we chose strong bases, the tool will come back with the weak cation exchanger. And if we chose weak acids, the tool would come back with the strong anion exchanger. And if we choose strong acids, the tool will come back with the weak anion exchanger. The next input requires us to put in what type of format do we want, syringe barrels or 96-well plates. So here we're selecting 96-well plates, and you look down below on the red arrow and you see that the format chosen will come back from the tool with the 96-well plate selected. The third input requires the further identification of what type of plate. There are standard plates, and then there's what we call a microelution plate, which is designed strictly for very small sample volumes. So the microelution plate is only for sample volumes that are less than 375 microliters. So when you have the situation where you have a larger amount of sample, which we know we will have for our particular experiment, we would select no for this particular response. And here's the larger sample size, 500 to 1000 microliters. So you can see now that the tool has the first four inputs. It can properly select what device you will need to run this particular method. It's going to select the type of sorbent, the MCX, because it's a strong cation exchanger and we have weak bases. It's going to select a 96-well plate, and the amount of sample will determine how much sorbent volume is required. So here it says we need 30 milligrams per well. And then it comes back and gives you the actual part number, and you can go and order that directly from the Waters online product availability system. So if you don't happen to have that in your laboratory, you can get that fairly quickly. Now, just to be clear, there are some built-in error messages, just to show you one quick one. For example, say we picked a 96-well plate and then we put yes to the microelution plate in question three, then put in a much larger sample than the plate was designed to hold, we would get an error message. And notice when the error message comes up down below, it will now also inform you that there is a problem because it won't select what format and give you a part number. So your process will stop, and now you'll have to go back in and sort of figure out what is inconsistent in your input responses. The next three inputs are allowing the actual tool to actually give you the step-by-step methods of your protocol. So here we have for our specific sample that we want to try is 500 microliters of sample volume. The analytes are present in 200 nanograms per mil concentration, and we're going to do six replicate samples. So we load that in, and now if you follow the blue arrow down below, you will actually see the specific SPE methods spelled out in detail for you, with the solvents, the volumes that you're going to need. And that's really the benefit of using this particular model for creating your SPE methods. Just a couple of minutes of input information and you have a method given to you. Let's take a look at a little bit more detail of the methods. We can see that the weak bases for our sample analyte types give us the strong cation exchanger. And then we have a actual series of steps in the procedure. Because we want to utilize ion exchange, we're going to put those bases onto the device in a low pH format so that they are charged. So we're going to pre-treat the sample with a phosphoric acid solution that's a diluent. Going to condition methanol, equilibrate with water, load the sample, and then wash with a low pH aqueous mixture. That's going to maintain the ion exchange for our weak bases, but allow other things to pass out, especially polar compounds. And then elute one, okay, is going to be in pure methanol. So that's going to now elute any compounds that are uncharged or are very nonpolar in nature. And then elute two, which is where our analytes will be, is at high pH. Now, the reason we go to high pH is we need to shut off the ion exchange mechanism. So we need to put the bases back in their uncharged state. And we're using high pH with methanol. So now we can release them through basically a reverse phase elution process. Tab 2 allows us now to prepare all the solutions and standards that we're going to need to test how well this method will work for us, especially in the areas of recovery and matrix effects. The formulations that we give you are basically been created through best practices. If you have any questions on that, please contact the Waters Technical Support Team, and they'll be more than happy to help you understand why certain solvents and things were used and certain volumes were used. So the tool now tells you how to prepare three of the solutions that you're going to need for the testing. A very concentrated stock standard solution at 100 times concentration. You can see that's labeled S1. We have the standards called S2, which are going to be at the concentration that we're going to be testing for in this method, which is the 200 nanograms per milliliter. And then we have that sample pretreatment, or the diluent solution, SD, which in this case here for the weak bases is going to be a low pH to keep the bases charged. So this happens to be a phosphoric acid solution. The next step is to prepare the actual plasma samples, and there are two. P1, which is going to be our pre-spiked plasma sample, and we show you exactly how to prepare that, and we'll go over that in the next slide. So here you see a little bit clearer how we're going to prepare the pre-spiked plasma sample, P1. We basically have the formulation on the left, so it shows you specifically the volumes and how to prepare it. And then we're going to have, as you see in the diagram on the right, basically you have your plasma. We're going to add in that concentrated standard solution, S1, and the sample diluent, and that will be our pre-spiked plasma samples. So those are going to be plasma samples with the compounds or the analytes pre-spiked in before any testing is done. The next plasma sample is what we'll call P2, and that is called the post-spiked plasma sample. So let's take a look at how that's prepared. From the formulation, as you see on the left, we're going to use the other half of that plasma and basically now add in the solvent that we used to make S1, not the actual standards, just the solvent. So if we use methanol, it's just pure methanol, and the sample diluent. And notice that this particular sample has the plasma in it, but no sample analyte. So this is why it's going to be called post-spike, because we're going to spike in the analytes after the SPE is is accomplished. So you can see on the diagram on the right, it's basically the plasma with some methanol and the sample diluent added. So we have all the solutions ready to go, and now we're actually going to go to tab 3. And tab 3 is going to show us how to run the experiments, calculate the recovery and the matrix effects to see if our method is satisfactory. Now, when you open up tab 3, you'll see a lot of information. So I'm going to, over these two slides, we're going to see what's there. The first thing you're going to notice is we're going to have some boxes, one for the pre-spike samples and one for the post-spike samples. And what these are going to do is tell you how to run the 6 replicate experiments, exactly what to do following your SPE method, and then where to place the results of all those. The 6 replicates will be averaged, and you can see the yellow boxes. So I'll show you a little bit more in detail how we fill that out. But just to complete the rest of the opening screen, down below we'll have the S2 values, okay, because we're going to be running the SPE method, and remember it has an elute 1 and elute 2 step, so we have to create 2 standard solutions for that. And then in down at the very end, you'll see the results of our total testing, which will give us the percent recovery and any matrix effects. So let's follow how this actually will work. Just to recall, this is our actual method that the tool provided for us. We're going to take our plasma sample, okay, in this case 500 microliters. We're going to add in our diluent, 500 microliters, and this is the low pH to give us the ability to keep the bases in their charged state. Going to condition with methanol, equilibrate, going to load the sample. We're going to wash with low pH water, okay, and the reason we're doing that is that's going to maintain the ion exchange of our analytes. They're still going to be charged, so they will not be able to be washed off, and this will wash off any other polar interferences that might be present. And then we actually have 2 elution steps, 1 in methanol and 2 in the high pH, in this case here, 4% ammonium hydroxide. The 1 in methanol is going to get off any uncharged species and any neutral compounds that now exist, and the 100% organic will basically elute that through reverse phase. Elute 2 now goes to a high pH. The reason we're going to high pH is we want to shut off the ion exchange system. So high pH, the bases go back into their uncharged form, and the high concentration of methanol will now release them by reverse phase. So this is our protocol that we will now run. Now let's take a look at what the protocol will actually look like. We're going to use that SPE method that we just saw, but we have a special way of running it. So in this case here, for our P1 pre-spiked samples, it says load the sample, okay, apply the SPE process, and then basically take the elute 1 and elute 2. In this case here, for the pre-spike, we're just going to add some water to them. So it tells you exactly how much to do that. So you're going to get 6 replicates from elute 1, 6 replicates from elute 2. You're going to add water to them and then provide the results from the LC mass spec, and then average them and basically put that value in the yellow box. So if you look over on the diagram on the right, you can see what we're doing. So we take our sample for P1, run it through the SPE method, collect elute 1 and elute 2, add water with to them. Okay, so now you have the pre-spiked elute 1, pre-spiked elute 2 with water added. Those will be the samples that we provide to the LC mass spec, and they're at a concentration of 100 nanograms per milliliter to keep everything the same. Now let's focus our attention on the post-spiked plasma sample, P2. Remember, there are no standards in this sample before it goes into the SPE device. So actually, if you look on the right, you see how the sample is going to go through the SPE device. We're going to collect elute 1 and elute 2, and then spike in the standards, the S2 solution. So you can see we're going to have six replicates with the elute 1 value and six replicates with the elute 2 value. So I've labeled them clearly P2, E1 after SPE, S2, P2, E2 after SPE, S2. So you can see where the data from those averages will be input into the tool. Just to clarify in your mind, basically we want to see the difference between running a blank plasma sample through the device, as you see on the far left, then adding the standards through it. So the standards never go through the SPE device, versus putting the standards in the sample originally and running them through the device. So the difference is, if any of the standards are not passing through, any of the analytes of interest are not passing completely through, then we will not get a 100% recovery. When the values for those end up being exactly the same from the mass spec, then that means we've got 100% recovery. So let's take a look in actually starting to put in some values, and these are just made up so that you can, you know, just understand how the tool is actually calculating these specific responses for you, so you can understand the impact as changes from your results will be evaluated. So what we're going to do is, for the pre-spike sample, we have for elute 1, we're going to have a value of 0. Remember, for our standards, our analytes, we don't want them to come out in elute 1. We want them in elute 2. And then in elute 2, I have 100,000. So you can see how that works. And then for the post-spike values, I'm going to have 100,000 for elute 1 and 100,000 for elute 2, as you would expect, because we're actually spiking those standards in at the end. Now, if you look over to the right here, I basically cut and pasted the response that you would see on your screen from the actual tool. And looking at the recovery values for elute 1 and elute 2, we can see if it makes any sense. For elute 1, we know that there should be none of our standards present there, and we get no recovery for them there. So if you compare the 100 value for the post-spike to the 0 value for the pre-spike, we get recovery of 0. And conversely, for elute 2, they're both at 100. So that means we get 100% recovery. So all the analytes that were pre-spiked into the SPE device basically get through and are completely eluted off in elute 2. So we have 100% recovery. So now we need to evaluate how well the method does for matrix effects in the LC mass spec. So in order to do that, we need to take our standard solution that we prepared S2 previously and modify and create two versions, one for comparing the elute 1 results and one for comparing the elute 2 results. Now remember, in our protocol, elute 1 is a pure methanol elution step. So basically we're just going to take S2 and add 500 microliters to the 500 microliters of S2 and now create S2E1. So this is our elute 1 reference solution for the S2 value, and take that 6 times replicates, and we have that average in there. And then for the elution step 2, remember, elution step 2 for our particular method, it was a high pH ammonium hydroxide. So we have to add that into our S2 so we can compare solutions identically. We have to be apples and apples with the solvents that we're looking at for comparison with mass spectrometry results. So in this case here, we have 500 microliters of S2. We add to it 500 microliters of ammonium hydroxide solution. Okay, and now we have our 6 samples. And again, all of the concentrations are set for 100 nanograms per milliliter to give us proper results. So you can see down below, I've identified the actual sample IDs as S2E1 on the left and S2E2 on the right. 6 replicates of each, and the average is input into the tool. Just so you can understand what the matrix effect calculation is actually looking at, Over on the left here, we have our blank sample matrix going through the SPE device. Then we add in our standards post-spiked, do an LC mass spec on that value. On step two, we take just the pure standards with no plasma, no sample matrix involved, and evaluate that by mass spec. So if there's any difference between those two values, that means something in the blank plasma is causing a problem with the mass spectrometry. So we do a rough comparison with the following equation. So we just relate the two of them to each other, the post-spiked on the top, the non-extracted neat solvent on the bottom, and we get our results. So ideally, both of them should be exactly the same, which says there is nothing that's interfering with my response on the mass spectrometer. But if there's a big difference between them, then you'll start to see whether we have a ion suppression effect or an ion enhancement effect. We'll show you that in the next few slides. So in this case here, when I compare the P2E2 after SPE S2 value, I know that's a lot to say, but that's just to keep it clear in your mind, to the S2E2 value up there on the top of the screen, and they both end up with results of 10 nanograms per milliliter, in this case just for discussion, I get no matrix effect. Okay, 10 divided by 10 minus 1 is 0. In the next case, notice that the MS result for the sample that had the blank plasma and that was spiked afterwards had a value of 2 nanograms per milliliter, even though we spiked in for 10 nanograms. But the response was only 2. And we know that the response for our solution should be 10. Notice now we have a value of minus 80%. And that indicates we have 80% ion suppression. So there's something in the blank sample matrix that is suppressing the response of our analytes of interest. And just to show you that in some cases you get an enhancement, the signal is actually larger than it should be. So in this case here for the blank sample coming through and being spiked, we get a value of 12, and the standards solution neat, we get a value of 10, we actually have 20% ion enhancement, a plus 20% ion enhancement. So these are very critical assessments, the recovery and the matrix effects, to make sure your assay is going to give you the results that you really need. So I'm just going to put a couple of these in here just for discussion so you can see some values. So I've loaded in values of for pre-spike 0 and 100, post-spike 100 and 100, and the solution 2, dilute 1, 100, and solution 2. Loop 2, 100. Notice I get ideal results. I get 100% recovery, okay, for the loop 2, which is where my analytes should be. So a loop 2, 100% recovery. Notice for a loop 1, no recovery, which is correct because my analytes should not be in a loop 1, they should be in a loop 2. So the recovery is excellent. And now let's look at the matrix effects. So matrix effects 100 to 100. Okay, means I have no matrix effects either in a loop 1 or a loop 2. And I'll show you some differences so that you can see how that actually makes sense and how the tool is actually doing all these calculations for you. Now I'm going to put in some different values. So let's look at the pre-spiked. I have 4,000 in a loop 1 and 96,000 in a loop 2. So if you look at a loop 1, the recovery is 4%. Should have been 100,000, but I only got 4,000, so I only got 4% recovery. In a loop 2, it should have been 100,000, but I got 96,000, so it's 96% recovery. So in total, I have all the analytes accounted for, but they're not in one elution container. They're in two different elution containers. Now let's take a look at the matrix effects. When we look at the matrix effects, we have to compare the S2 results for loop 1 and the post-spike results for loop 1, and notice they're both 100, so we have no matrix effects, and the same thing occurs for a loop 2. So here we have a situation the total recovery is okay, but it is in two different elution volumes, and there's no interferences with the matrix effects. Just another one, just to have you think through what can happen. Here we have 0 and 10,000 for the pre-spiked, and again 100,000 and 10,000 for the post-spiked, and 100,000 and 100,000 for S2. So let's look at the results we get here. For E1, we have no recovery for the analytes, as we would expect. And because there's 100,000 for elute 1 for the post spike and 100,000 for the S2 elute 1, we have no matrix effects. Let's take a look at elute 2. Here we have a value of 10,000 and elute 2 for the pre-spiked and elute 2 for the post spiked is also 10,000. So when we look over to recovery, it says 100% recovery. That's very interesting. Even though we should have 100,000 there. So what is that telling us? Well, it says that sometimes you'll get a recovery value that is okay, but it's resulting in a situation where you may also have severe matrix suppression taking place. Because remember, the S2 solution says I should have 100,000 values for these. So the fact I'm getting 10 and 10 means I'm only getting basically a very small response, and I should have a much larger response on the mass spectrometer. So this is saying I have 90% of ion suppression for that particular set of experiments. Let's do one more, and we can take a look in this case here. Pre-spike 0 and 10,000 for elute 2, and the post-spiked is 100,000, and for elute 2 it's 50,000 and 100 and 100 for the S2s. Now let's look at the results we get. We get very, very poor percent recovery. Notice that elute 2 says I should have 50,000, that is the post-spike value. And elute 2 for the pre-spiked is only 10,000. So if you look down at elute 2, the recovery is only 20%. So I'm losing a lot in the SPE device. Now, for the matrix effects, take a look at the S2 value for E2, and that's 100,000. But notice what the post-spike value is, only 50,000. So that says I've actually creating a situation where the sample matrix is causing a lot of ion suppression, in this case here 50% of ion suppression. So just be careful when you're thinking about how to interpret what the tool is telling you as you input the data into the actual tool. Okay, the tool will calculate all the interactions that you'll need to know to evaluate whether your sample protocol is satisfactory for your needs. So in this case here, that would be something that we would want to go back and do additional work on and optimize. So just to summarize, if we get to an ideal result situation where our analytes are located, in this case here, only in elute 2 and there's no matrix effects, that's our ideal situation. And at that point in time, you can actually stop using the tool for any additional work in creating the method. What you'd need to do is just go through and prove out validation and things of that nature. But the tool itself has been very satisfactory in creating the right product to use for an SPE device, as well as the right protocol to use. Now, as you saw, okay, so we've just completed tabs 1, 2, and 3. And remember that there are additionally available to you separately tabs 4 and 5. Tab 4 would be for better understanding of ion exchange, why it works, and that would be especially helpful for your new colleagues in the laboratory. And then tab 5 would be if your results for recovery and matrix effects were not satisfactory, you could go through an optimization program. So just in summary, we have a situation where there's a lot of support materials available to you 24/7 online at the waters.com website, so please take advantage of that. A lot of materials for sample preparation or LC or UPLC or UPC squared technology, lots of very helpful information there available to you at your fingertips any time of the day. We have several webinars listed for you, and you can take a look and activate those and sit through them. Again, very helpful for people that have new colleagues coming into the laboratory to help them better understand and be more productive. There are many publications available to you. This happens to be one that features solid phase extraction technology, very carefully developed for you to make it easy to understand what physically is going on in the SPE devices, and especially focuses on the Oasis technology. So again, highly recommended for people new in the laboratory. And at this point, I really must acknowledge the amazing amount of work that went on in the background here by Dr. Mark Bainham and Aaron Chambers, who created all the protocols and then turned that into a very powerful tool for you to use day in and day out in your laboratory to make very powerful and effective solid phase extraction methods for bioanalytical samples. My colleagues, Anil Korab, Doug McCabe, and Sylvie Gondon, that allowed me to work on this program to basically prepare it, and then they were able to get it out to you so that you can now utilize it in your laboratory. So thanks for your attention, and good luck in solid phase extraction.